maturity in executing complex program at Infosys. Can you tell us something about that?
Can you hear it?
Yes. Yeah, no, I think executing a complex programs obviously is not so easy stuff, right? And what goes behind the executing a complex program is what kind of preparation that you do, how much of understanding that you have in what it involves, right? And ability to, analyze and make sure that you can understand what risks are there and make sure the risks have been prepare dependencies been planned very effectively, right? So I think that what really it takes. Obviously, it also required a ability to do a program management, because everything has to come together. And when you're running a complex program, you need to make sure that you understand each and bit and pieces and bring it together and run like a program. It will, you can get it.
Along with that, what is the biggest risk you have taken over?
See, I have there are a number of programs there where I was not sure if I would be able to deliver to it. I would be able to run and really get the result out. So there are a number of those programs where, I have done it. So, I was implementing one of the program for one of the customer, a very large payment transformation, and I had no idea if we would be able to really achieve it because it was a very complex environment, a lot of dependency on the customer side. And when you don't know what you don't know is the toughest part, right? So that's where the problem was. But I think we took heads on, we started learning through the process and we could really solve it. But some of those could be the way to really look into it.
What is your opinion on data monetization?
I think just absolutely data is a king, companies who own the data is obviously are, controlling the whole world. Today, the world is controlled by, all of us controlled by likes of Facebook, likes of Google, because they have the data. See, data is obviously is becoming more important because the more and more customer centricity is coming. The whole user experience, customer experience, and it's all dependent on how much you understand about the end user, right? And that's where the data plays a significant role. So as you walk into a retail store on a display, based on what the retail store will recognize who are you, and it will start showing you exactly what you're looking for. Like, I don't know how many of time you have gone on your Facebook and you see it suddenly showing up what exactly you search. Probably you've never gone through those things in anywhere else. See, I have like Alexa at my home and I speak and we talk something. Alexa is recording everything. Remember, Alexa is recording everything. And suddenly I go to Facebook and see Alexa, Facebook is giving me the option of what I was discussing. I had no idea what I was discussing with, in front of Alexa, but it's showing it. I think data is significant, but obviously we have to also understand the secrecy laws around it and make sure that we are very responsible for the data that we are rolling. See, I think those are the newer technology. Those are the things that are going to define the way the world is going to operate. I was just looking at an example of Tesla, right? And how Tesla is evolving this whole self-driving cars. 4 or 5 years back, probably no one wanted to believe that self-driving can happen, right? But it can, it will happen. It is happening in US anyway, people are using. Number of times people ask me question, will it be efficient in India? And everyone knows that the traffic in India is unpredictable. So people say, no, by default, it will fail. But I think that will actually it will be more successful, because you're using the machine learning to really apply all the learning rather than individual learning, right? And that's where I think that machine learning can play a significant role. So I think that's where the industry is moving. Everything that we do has a machine learning involved. And if you really start looking into those data and you start making those decisions, cognitive computing, start using cognitive computing, start making decisions, I think the world will be completely different.
Do you see the opportunity for new graduates in that field?
Absolutely. There's opportunities for everyone. I think all of us has to learn the language. And I saw in the fair today, there was some of people talking about the Python and they're already doing some research on that. Absolutely. Why not? See, and easiest thing to do is use the machine learning from things around you, anything around you, right? And you will see an application, you can really do some things around it.
Next one, how should India's entrepreneurs, innovators, should
So I think that's a very interesting question. And today, you know, one thing that goes in India, obviously, one is obviously the environment and ecosystem, which is sometimes is not really well supported. You know, if they look into a taxation system, itself is killing some of the startups. But I think the biggest challenge the startups has is the access to the users. I think Indian users are still not really used to of, you know, helping and transforming some of the things. That's where you'll see the startups in India has been very limited success rather than likes of what happened in the US. But I think today we are seeing things are changing in terms of there is a more, you know, support from coming from the, be the funding, be the idea, be it ecosystem. There are a lot of support moving from world, you know, rest of the world to India. And that's why I think the slowly the startups are really getting successful. But my thinking is that it will take some time to really compete with the global world, because what happens in the US, what happens in, you know, likes of Israel, you know, the Israel is one of the top startup setup, right? I think in India is still a long way to catch up, but I think it has in last 3-4 years obviously startups has gone up.
Next is what is going to be the next big disruption which we haven't yet looked at? Like input uncertainty is the big disruption. So what will be the future disruption we haven't looked at?
I think my thinking is the biggest disruption is coming with the usage of drone technology, right? I think the drones are still limited, very limited. Drones with the autonomous, it will change the world. You will see a drone taxi, you will see a, you know, drone car, you will see drone delivery. I think some of these things are still limited because of security reasons. But my thinking is next innovation and evolution is around the drone technology. Why not? Why not? I think, see, if you look into Indian economy, it's doing very well, right? And today, it has already become a number 4th in terms of the economy, and it will soon very soon catch up with the other world economies as well. You know, so I think that way, I think India is upcoming fast. I think our biggest challenge is still the reach of the technology to the common users, right? I think one good thing has happened in India is this whole access to the internet has brought the, you know, access of information to every individual, every this thing. But I think this whole digital literacy is one of the important, you know, building blocks in doing that. Secondly, I think we have to also see how we apply technology in everything we do. You know, a developed country requires every, you know, government system to every other system to operate much more smarter way. The third is obviously our own mindset. I think it will take some time to really get the mindset change. But I think we are on the way, the right pace. I think we will get there.
What does India mean for?
India means for me everything. India is my home. My you know, that's where I belong to, and I always believe whatever you work for, there is always a way you can contribute to back to your country. So, you know, obviously, that's the way I would define it. It's all me. I am India, and India is me.
Today's ceremony, you remember your days, your college days?
Absolutely. It reminded me all my days. Actually, in fact, I missed my graduation ceremony. Interestingly, today I got to wear the gown and remember that I can also, you know, I also got graduated. I think it reminded me all my college days. In fact, there is a people are planning for reunion now, you know, end of this year, we have 25th reunion. So that bringing me now excitement that I need to go back to my college. And after coming in, at least now thinking that I have to go back to college and at least spend some time there. I think the graduation ceremony was phenomenal. I think it's a wonderful, wonderfully organized, and I saw a lot of talents in terms of the people who were showing the project, the enthusiasm, the passion. I think it was, you know, huge. One thing that I always do is when people walk through the dais, I watch the language, the body language, and I saw at least 80% of the people are really excited. They were really enthused by what's happening, and that's why that defined the experience. And I think I was really excited to hear that. Now, obviously, I would always request all of you to focus on learning. And my biggest challenge to this generation is don't run away from the problem. don't switch job every 2 years. I think that's a in the mentality of the people, switch job. I know you can take more risk. Our days, we used to learn from our father's, parents' lesson of loyalty. Nowadays, the loyalty point is going down. So I think if you can really increase the loyalty point, I'm not expecting you to run, 10 years, 20 years, but at least loyalty to learn something and at least become something through that process.
Value and ethics.
Loyalty is all about, value and ethics is one part. The loyalty is about the commitment to do something and continuing to do something.